Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Good evening, everyone. Before we start tonight's meeting, Commissioner Eddie Boswell is going to offer an invocation followed by leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Eddie?
Let's bow our heads, please. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for such a beautiful day, and just thank you for all the blessings you bestow upon us. And dear God, let us be mindful of those that are in our community that need help and are still in time of dire need. Let us be mindful of what we can do to help them. And dear God, just be with us as we make decisions that will affect the county. These things we ask in thy name. Amen.
Let's face the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Eddie. We'll now call the meeting to order. Welcome to all of you to this, the second meeting of March 2012, Alamance County Commission. We're glad that you're here. First item on the agenda is the approval and review of the agenda itself. Commissioners, if we can take a minute and review the agenda, also the items that are proposed to be on the consent agenda, and decide if there's anything there we want to remove, as well as the order of the meeting itself. There are no comments or changes. We'll have entertain a motion to approve the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Presented. Thank you, Eddie, Bill. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. We'll now move to public comments. First speaker tonight is Mr. Lash Reitenberry. Mr. Reitenberry, if you come forward, please. Welcome to you.
Terry, I hope I don't embarrass you. I was on the tractor, and the more I rode, the madder I got. So I kicked my boots off and changed shirts, told the wife I'm going to the meet. So I came down the interstate one eye and all. I want you folks to think, what would we do if we didn't have him running 287G, what kind of mess would we be in? Now, I know you got a commissioner that wants to criticize him, wants to hammer 287G, but you would be short several years of $6 million. And he's not running a business for profit. He doesn't run a department for profit. He runs the Alamance County Sheriff's Department. And he's probably the best and most popular sheriff we've had in my lifetime. And I think we all need to support him. The 287G, yeah, it's dwindling down and the money's not going to be there. But that's not his fault. He's doing one hell of a job, pardon my French. He's made money for this county. You wouldn't have had it if he hadn't have been in there. But my problem also with this county is the county employees. We show no respect for our employees. I think we need to give each employee across the board a $1,000 a year raise. You've got some employees that work for the county don't make $20,000 a year. And then when you put them on a furlough day, all you're doing is cutting their pay. That's all you've done. I don't want to see taxes go up. But if you've got to raise taxes 2, 3, 4 cents, we're still getting a deal. It's still a deal for this county. And I know a lot of senior citizens can't afford it. But we have got to face reality. We've paved parking lots that didn't need paving. We've spent money that didn't need to be spent. I just look at this table here. Heck, we didn't need that table. We have got to quit spending money. But we have got to thank our employees. And I'm asking you to give the county employees a raise. Every one of them. Don't give a 2% raise because you've got people that make $100,000 a year that are going to get a whole lot more than that person that makes 20. Give them $1,000 a year right across the board. But let's look after our employees.
Thank you, Lash.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Mr. Richard Weber. Mr. Weber, welcome to you. Come forward.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity to come and to address the county commissioners. It's the first time that I've ever been here. I've been a resident of Alamance County for about 11 and a half years, and we've enjoyed most of our time here. To start, I just want to read, since the topic is going to be concerning a county ordinance. It's the noisy dog ordinance. It shall be unlawful for the keeper or other custodian of any dog to allow it to bark, whine, howl, or make any other noise for a protracted period so as to result in a serious annoyance or interference with the reasonable use and enjoyment of neighboring premises. I know what venue I'm in. I'm not here to present one side of a case and the other party's not present. But I do want to try to figure out, is there a way that this ordinance can be more publicized? I came across it only because there was a problem. I was not aware of it, and I don't think the other party was originally aware of it either. In dealing with this situation, we've had excellent response from two individuals from the Sheriff's Department, the Sheriff himself and Major Brown. Most of the deputies have done a fine job as well. However, even on that respect, I don't know that the ordinance is well known. And lots of times when we call, sometimes you never know who you get when you call. Different answers are given that are not in line with what the ordinance actually says, including animal control. So one of the things that I wanted to bring up was just, is there some kind of way in which that can be brought out a little bit more? Another thing is not only the awareness, but what type of enforcement things that just a regular citizen can avail himself. It shouldn't be a criminal matter. It shouldn't be even a civil matter where we're having to call on law enforcement to do so. And again, as I said, the response has been excellent for the times that when it's been something that has been totally unbearable, they have always done to me far beyond what they should have. They've got important things to do. We live in what's called an extra jurisdictional territory, an EJT, and no one ever seems to want to give us a straight answer for that. We live in a subdivision where the houses are, usually about a half an acre, three-quarters of an acre, so they're not far apart, and there's no, homeowners association. It's just outside the city of Graham, city limits, but we're well within the county. And so one of the main things that I wanted to just bring out, besides telling that little background, is to focus on two questions. What can be done to make citizens more aware of the ordinances in general, and this one in particular? Because I think that most responsible citizens don't want to violate any laws or any ordinances. And some of them may not be aware that that an ordinance does have a certain force. What kind of force of law does it have? Second question is what's the real status of the EJTs in the county? I mean, there have been other issues involved that would be satisfied by knowing what an EJT really is and what its status is. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. Our next speaker is Mr. Eddie Shue. Eddie, come forward, please. Welcome.
Hi. Evening, Mr. Chairman. I take some of that $1,000 too, man. You ain't giving me no raises. I know the sheriff ain't prepared for this tonight, but if I heard right, at the other meeting, Commissioner Sutton was hinting at strong enforcement of 287G.
We'll talk about it.
Okay, I'm assuming that's what he was hinting at. What I have tried over the years and never have got an answer, what does it cost? Now, we know what we make off of federal inmates, and we know what we make off housing of the 287G people. But there is a cost. A deputy, let's pretend I'm a deputy. I know I'm stretching it. And I'm out here patrolling. Now, my job today is to look out for crime. And I see a criminal going down the street there with an expired inspection sticker or tag that don't look right. So I stop him. I talk to him. I spend such and such amount of time with him. Then I decide he needs to go in, so I put him in under arrest. I bring him back up to the jail. There are certain things I have to do there. And he may wind up with a detainer if he happens to be a detainable situation there. Now that is a cost. I have never, Mecklenburg lists their costs, Wake County lists their costs. I have never in all these years found out what it cost us. And I know the sheriff's not prepared for this, but in case it is brought up more enforcement, I would like to know what does it cost just one time. Because that's, you know, that has never been told. It's never been told to us. Our average cost, I would say any deputy, it's going to take him 2 hours from the time he arrests somebody to the time they're processed. My guess, off the wild, wild guess. But that's not counting the times that he's bringing people back that don't make it into the program. That don't take the time that he's patrolling, not looking for this particular fellow, but patrolling and making other stops. I mean, so what is the cost we ought to have? If these other counties can do it, I think we can come up with some kind of cost. Thank you.
Our next speaker, I believe, is Ms. Jordan, but I can't read you. Is it Rebecca?
No, Alexa.
Alexa.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Welcome to you, Ms. Jordan.
And I don't have much to say. I am the present chair of the Human Relations Council. Appreciate the support of the commissioners in appointing members. We have a potential for 20 members. We right now have 13. We're seeking additional members that represent various parts of the county. And one other thing I wanted to tell you is that we've been meeting at the company shops, but we can no longer meet there. So we are starting to meet at the Church of the Holy Comforter on Broad Street. But thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Jordan. Our next speaker is Ms. Pat Bailey. Ms. Bailey, welcome to you.
Yes. I want to comment first. Don't take it all my 3 minutes. There was a group of senior citizens the other day, and I heard the term, the lady said, I'm tired of the neighbor's dog woofing. And I said, you know, ma'am, what does a woof mean? You know, she said, oh, bark, bark. So put that the new word for your language there.
Okay. Yes, ma'am, I'll do that.
Woofing. What's that woofing? Okay, since I'm your history commissioner, as you folks have forgot about, all right, I'm going to report to you about a war that was going on here in the county some years ago, and somebody said it didn't exist, but I know it did because I wrote stories about it and went, say what? The ladies had a war with aprons because they played upmanship, and I can make a prettier apron than you can. Well, this year's coming up Uncle Eli's quilting party, and we've pulled together a collection of aprons back from the apron wars. We invite you to come see them. And furthermore, we invite you to the quilting party, which, by the way, is the first Thursday in April for 81 consecutive years. It's a folk custom here in the county, and the state says it doesn't count. Make it count. All right, furthermore, here's the invitation to the apron wars. And how often do you get invited to an apron show? How about aprons surrounded by about 50 or 60 quilts? And on your good behavior, you can save for a picnic lunch. The picnic line chow line will probably last from that basketball hoop over to that one. And the date's April the 5th. And one other thing, I just have to have some handy here, that when I talk to you individually, you say, I know somebody that's got a pretty quilt. Well, you just tell those people to crank it down because here's your pre-registration from the show. There you go. Now, I could have brought you a name tag and pre-registered you.
Linda's been working on hers all week. She get credit for doing it early.
She gets front of the lunchtime.
That's right.
She's just making it.
I said this because I'm saying, you know, man, what's your woofing?
All right.
any questions about Uncle Lynn? Has been down there. You've been down there. You've been down there. You've been the uncle only 81 years, Tim. You know,
I'm only 62.
He's waiting.
Don't you believe him? He's 82. He's been down there a long time before you.
He was down there before this
when
started.
When did I see you down there?
You've seen me down there.
Well,
it's
come
been
on back.
About 3 or 4 years.
Come on back.
I will.
The aprons. You think of aprons nowadays, they got them all fancy printing and stuff, but some of these aprons are crocheted. And way back to the days of the 30s and 40s, you had the home demonstration. This is taking my 3 minutes, but you need to know. The Home Demonstration Club ladies, they went out in the county and taught the ladies how to do this, how to housekeep, how to do all this kind of, like, back then, all the children had worms. And so they show you how to really work. And when you did the laundry, you know, to iron the thing, make kill of the, all right, they showed you how to put pillowcases on. They did all these kind of things. Home economists. All right. Back then, the ladies wore aprons from the field to the farm to the garden to the cook stove. I can't hear it.
But, right, unfortunately, we can. But I will say this, and I'll begin our commissioner's responses by simply saying that if you have not been to the quilting party, it is worth a treat. And when I go down there, and I was there last year, there are people from everywhere. There are people from counties all around. There are people from out of state. Well, and it's a lot of fun, and I will say this, my understanding is that they've completed some of the renovations and upfittings to the Eli Whitney Center, and it's definitely worth going. So thank you for coming tonight. Thank you for our invitation.
The roof still leaks.
We'll get to that.
Pat, what was the furthest distance somebody had?
Oh, one lady flew in from California with some suits, apron quilts in her suitcase.
It was great.
And by the way, last year he got picked up, made headlines in London and also in California.
Press, yeah.
Yeah.
Press,
so thank you, Pat.
It's local and people say it doesn't matter.
Thank you very much. That completes our public comments. Commissioners' responses at this time, anyone?
I'll have some in regards to Lash's comments, but I'm going to incorporate them when the sheriff speaks.
Okay. Anyone else?
Just out of curiosity, the gentleman's concern about the dog ordinance. Can you direct him? I mean,
it's online.
It is online. Yes, okay.
You did find it online.
If he would wish to have a conversation with a member of the staff, who should he talk to?
Talk to me about it. He talk to the planning director about it.
Yeah. Mr. Weber, Mr. Clyde Albright is our county attorney, and Mr. Jason Martin is the planning director, and you may want to schedule a time and just sit down.
Right.
Thank you. Thank you, Eddie. Any other comments right at this time? Okay, well, let's move to the next item on the agenda, which will be 287G ICE program update. Welcome the Honorable Sheriff Terry Johnson.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Good evening. And I'd like to say thank you, Mr. Weber, what you said, but he does have a problem out there. And, Lord, I don't know how to explain it, but, you know, we've talked with him several times, and he has really been bearable what's going on, but because of the situation, there's only so much we can do. And we've even looked at trying to revisit some of these issues to maybe make recommendations to Jason or somebody to change, because we're, as I told Mr. Honeycutt the other day, I catch more grief and there's more problems over animals than you do a double homicide in this county. I told him that the other day. And I think the county at some point in time needs to look at some of these issues that is confronting the people here and try to work out some solution to give us more teeth, more power to deal with some of these things. But that's neither here nor there, but I want to thank you, Mr. Weber, because I know you've been through a lot. All right, I was asked to give an update on the 287G program here in Alamance County. Currently today, we had 405 inmates in the Alamance County Detention Center. There were 69 U.S. Marshal prisoners, which has come up considerably from some time ago. There were 29 ICE or immigrant detainers filed here, and 27 from our misdemeanor state program for a total of 405. Now, I was asked and have been questioned about why the immigrant population seems to be down, the criminal immigrant population here in Alamance County. First of all, I was talking to the public information officer today with the Immigration and Customs Enforcement. And, of course, they say that the 287G program, the jail enforcement model, appears to be working not only here but nationwide. It accounts for some of the population being down. Two, that due to the immigrant population moving out because of lack of jobs here is one of the reasons. And certainly the economy. If there's no work, a lot of them are returning to Mexico is what we've been told. Also, the Drug Enforcement Administration Task Force is working. We have people assigned to that here in Alamance County on a lot of our major drug traffickers. We're still not getting but a very small percentage of that. But I have been jumped by Sheriff of Randolph and Sam Page in Rockingham about our drug traffickers now moving over in their counties. And, you know, that's still not catching, you know, those drug traffickers. But Sam gave me an example of 1,000 pounds they seized a couple weeks ago over there. Were known to Alamance County. And I hope that's happening, but I'm hoping we're able to catch them. They just don't move and cause other residents of North Carolina or United States more problems. They appear to be, and according to some like more lenient rules regarding illegal immigrants and arrest from Washington, D.C., when they can file detainers or when they will file detainers on people. I know in a while back, you know, when they were driving their operator's license and some other, there were detainers filed, they were hailed, not anymore. And I'll give you an example of that from this month's response. Also, there appears to be some reduction in manpower or refocusing of manpower by the federal ICE agents looking for the more serious individuals in North Carolina and the United States. And certainly there has been a recommendation to cut $17 million out of the 287G program. However, that is for the task force program. There's 287G jail enforcement model and there's 287G task force model. The task force is where they go out and do investigations out in the community, arrests for violations like human trafficking, drug trafficking, false identification, various crimes that they can arrest. Well, the proposal is to cut that $17 million out of that particular portion of the 287G program, which actually has nothing to do with the 287G jail enforcement. However, if you're not getting inmates arrested, you're not getting inmates into the jail enforcement model. And that's what's happening nationwide, statewide, and countywide here. Also, the advocate groups are educating the immigrants about the amounts of money they need to carry to pay for no operator's license or other criminal violations, or how much bond is used last, and they're carrying it with them. I mean, we've had several of the immigrants tell us that. They're being educated along those lines. So when they go in the manager's office, they lay down the money, pay the fine on, walk out the door, or have the money, post the bond, walk out the door. That means they never get processed by 287G because they have to come behind the jail detention doors to be processed, in which the questions are asked that determine whether they're here illegally or legally and for them to be processed. And certainly, another one, I had another informant tell me that they are paying attention when the law enforcement agencies are changing shifts. At that point in time, they choose to go to work while the law enforcement agencies are changing shifts and swapping out. They also know when law enforcement, and believe me, the drug traffickers have done this for years. They come by any office we have, if we have it here, get license number, license tags, try to look at people to know who to look for in drug undercover situations. And they also know when we are at peak, when our agencies are out on the street and they choose not to travel now. And a lot of that's happening. And there's other unknown reasons, I'm sure, that I'm unaware of here in Alamance County, but it's everywhere. Give you a good example, this month so far, as of the 19th, we arrested, there's been 19 that's been brought in that were criminal illegal immigrants or operating vehicles with no license stuff. Out of those 19, the federal government released 3 on their own recognizance, 5 because they were lawful permanent residents here and had a card. They released them to go to court, whatever they have to be. We had one that was had a visa, and we had one that was we looked at hard as and was a United States citizen. So right there is 8, nice 10 out of 19 that was brought into the detention center. And by releasing these individuals used to not be released. Detainers were placed on them. There we've lost 9 where we normally would have that in the detention center.
You had 10 that had excuses, and you had 9 that, what happened to the 9?
Their detainers were put on those. And, yes, sir. For instance, and I'll just give you the charges. Released on their own cargoes, no operators, lifeless, reckless driving. They released them. Assault and battery, that was a lawful permanent residence. They released them because they're lawful permanent residence. Failure to appear, lawful permanent residence released them. Resist, obstruct, and delay, a detainer was filed on that one. Failure to appear, released. Failure to appear on one, a detainer was filed because there was other records associated with that individual. Under the influence, driving while license revoked was a U.S. citizen that was processed through here. Driving while license revoked and speeding, a detainer was filed because they had previous other run-ins with the law. Possession of cocaine, that individual had a visa. Under the influence, a detainer was filed. Traffic of marijuana, a detainer was filed. Assault on a female, a detainer was filed. No operator's license, was a lawful permanent residence. No operator's license, released on their own recognizance. No operator's license, detained because of previous record. Driving while license revoked was a lawful permanent residence. No operator's license, released on their own recognizance. No operator's license, detained because of previous criminal history. And possession of cocaine, no operator's license, resist, obstruct, and delay, a detainer was filed. Sorry.
Sheriff, what's the name of the program that is replacing that part of the 287G?
Well, there's really not. Well, there's a secure communities program that a lot of your detainees, like in O'Connor, we have 6 287G sites. Okay, the rest of the counties have the secure communities.
Okay, how is that
different? Okay, how is it different? If you brought to the Alamance County Jail, which is a 287G program, you are immediately interviewed, detainers filed if it is appropriate. On secure communities, you're fingerprinted. Those fingerprint goes to either Charlotte, Atlanta, or if offices close all the way to Miami, it may be 3 to 4 hours, maybe 2 days before they send back, we want to put a detainer on this guy. Well, most of the time, that individual has posted bond and gone. So the most efficient, in my opinion, efficient as far as catching those criminal aliens that are a threat to our citizens is the 287G program, because several have slipped through the secure communities because the response was not back in time.
Under the proposed changes, will the counties that have 287G retain that program?
If they are operating effectively and efficiently.
So they won't automatically or gradually be changed over to secure communities.
You're asking me to answer for the federal government. I've been told that the ones that are here, there will be no new ones added, is what I've been told. But I cannot speak for what the federal government will do with the 287G program. I can't tell you. I can tell you we're going to run it as long as they allow us to run it and do what we're supposed to do and get the criminals off the streets here in Alamance County. I can tell you that.
Of the 29 that you have over there now under ICE, how many of those are local?
Probably 15. We are a 72, the only over 72 hour holding facility in the state of North Carolina. And a lot of what we had previously was coming out of Wake County and down east. And with their numbers going down and releasing them down there on the own recognizance, that they never make it here. So, but I want you to understand, every 2-3 days, ICE is coming, picking up a load, given that's why we're staying at this level. Now, what we're waiting to hear from ICE, you know, we've agreed to go down east and pick up these individuals and try to bring them in. And if we were able to do that, there may be some that are being held, you know, that may later on be released by a judge or something. Maybe we can get to get in here and then get them to the deportation proceeding.
If Sam up in Rockingham or the sheriff down in Randolph or any other county, mm-hmm. If they run them through secure communities and they find out that they have, just like we found out, what, 10 out of 19
yes, sir.
Had enough against them to keep, to put detainers on them, is Sam doing the same thing and bringing them here? I mean, who's housing his people that he...
We have held some for Sam. We have held some for Castle County. But that, a lot of times, they may be, say, Sam... catches them, their detainers put on those secure communities, any other county for security, they will come here before 72 hours. If it's over 72 hours, they either got to release them within 48 hours or they've got to come here to Alamance County.
Did we talk to that lady in Atlanta? Did you call her?
You talking about, oh, heck.
Just the initials.
Yeah. I've talked, she called up here. But Eddie Carr come and met with us on some stuff, but it was basically just the status of 287G program, how we were operating. I have asked them down there we'll take whatever they can send us. But the problem is everybody's down in Georgia opened up a new holding facility in the state of Georgia, and that's when we stopped transporting out of Georgia up here.
It's like I mentioned to you, you know, when we first started talking about this, this lady in Atlanta says yeah. She's willing to come. Well, it's
Skinner.
Well, I wasn't going to say it, but yeah. Yeah. You won't give her name. But she said she was willing to come here in 45 days. This has been 45 days ago, and she says she was willing to come up and sit down and rediscuss it. So that's why I was hoping we had called her.
Well, when you say discuss it, if it's with the commissioners, won't it have to be in a public hearing? Or are you talking about discuss it with you,
ever has arranged.
Okay.
Legally.
Okay, legally. Okay, all right. I got you. Okay.
I mean, you know, they've been up before. But, no, you know, with all due respect to Lash or anybody, you know, I'm not trying to criticize as much as I just want information. I mean, I've been on this, you know, we knew what 287G was before they even called it 287G.
Before I ever come, sure.
Yeah, that was just the regulation number. That's all that was. And if we didn't have Sheriff Johnson, I know we wouldn't even be in this because we had prior sheriffs, prior candidates that didn't even want to do it. So, yeah, I'm thankful, but to ask questions about, you know, whether we can do more or not, whether we're doing all that we can, I don't think that's criticism. I just think that's my responsibility as a commissioner, because I'm sitting here saying that, you know, we budgeted $6 million for revenue and that we're only going to be getting, what, three, roughly?
You'll be lucky to get that.
Naturally, my concern is there. And,
I understand.
I do know what we're facing nationwide. As far as the administrations, but Pendergraph down in Charlotte told me, and he was the first sheriff to do 287G, and now he's running for Congress.
Yes,
he's
sir.
A county commissioner in Mecklenburg, and he's running for Sue Myrick's seat, and it's all but a gimme. He told me that if the Republicans take the White House, the House stays as it is, and the Senate reverts back to Republicans, but definitely the White House, he said that 287G is going to be reborn. It's what he told me. Now, he's just one person.
Let me tell you this. I concur with what he's saying along those lines, and certainly not slapping nobody in the face. But I'm telling you, a lot of stuff is coming across that border. This nation has turned their back on as far as terrorists, as far as drug traffickers, as far as murders, we need to open our eyes to. And thank goodness that we started the program when we started and got the publicity we got, because a lot of people of those natures don't come here now.
But you're right about I know of a situation that I was told this weekend where I don't want to give the whole – because it gives away too much. But a person in Guilford County told me they live in a mobile home park. And they told me that when the police, State Highway Patrol, or the Sheriff's Department is near them doing roadblocks, that they'll get a phone call back to the mobile home park from one person. and say, watch out. And they'll all stay home until they leave.
Absolutely.
And they've got so many illegal aliens in Chatham County, they're literally running into each other. They're having wrecks down there running into each other. Now, that's a fact. And so I just want us to be on top of our game, and I don't mean, I'm not trying to say you're not doing the best that you can, but you know I support doing all that we can.
Yes, sir. And I want you to understand, I don't have no problem, you know, with the questions you asked. They're good, viable questions. And certainly I want you to understand that I have the same feelings for the citizens of this county as you do. And probably if it had not been for you, the 287G program, I wouldn't even known about it when I come into office.
Well, if it wasn't for you as sheriff, we wouldn't be doing it either. Right. Yeah, so.
Well, thank you.
And I mean it.
Well, I do too. But the Board of Commissioners here, and I'm talking to all of you, have been real good in keeping the citizens of Alamance County in your thoughts as far as our enforcement efforts. And I will tell you this, as long as I'm sheriff and that 287G program is there, we're going to do the program the best we can do it.
If there's any way, the only thing I would hope that we could do as a PR person, from my standpoint, your standpoint, and I hope others, you know, I believe with all my heart we got police chiefs in this county that couldn't care less about it. I believe that. I believe that we've got magistrates that when they tell me that they let them go without, they put them into the court system without any idea of who they really are, if that doesn't scare everybody, we got to get more emphasis put on the judges that allow the magistrates to have such a weak wet noodle policy. I think we need to do all that we can to get the police departments to see it as we see it, because it's
We've got some in the county that do, and I think the majority of them do see it. They're not as, I don't think, as educated as our people is as far as the 287G program and the workings of it. But I can tell you, I really believe right now in Alamance County, we probably have the best group of overall chiefs of police that we've ever had here as far as working relationship. You know, do we all see eye to eye on everything? Absolutely not. We probably never will. You know, but I can tell you when it comes to enforcement of the law, I feel like all of them want it to be. But when you got say, I got 269 employees, I can't answer. I'm supposed to be able to answer for all of them, but you never know if they catch one and not sure and let them go unsure. You don't know that. But I can tell you this, we're certainly working with the chiefs and the agencies here trying to sing from the same sheet of music. But as you say, I'm sure sometimes it don't happen.
Well, it's not all of them.
Yeah. And I also, before I step down, Eddie, where did he go? You were given the cost of holding an inmate in the 287G program of $46 or something like. But let me tell you this, whether they are $46 and something night. But whether they're American citizens or immigrants or whatever, if they're out here on the highway violating the law, we got to deal with them. That don't add no cost to the 287G program. When they come into that jail in custody is when the cost starts. You understand what I'm saying?
I hear what you're saying. Exactly. But, okay, then I would be asking.
It's not the time for dialogue.
Well, I was asked.
If he wants to come by, I'll show him the sheet, because we figured it up every year, how much it cost to hold inmate, how much was possible profit on something.
He told me that, and that's not what I asked. But he had told me.
Any other questions for the sheriff?
Okay. Thank you.
Next item is debt refinancing. Craig or Tim, who's going to talk about this?
I am. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In front of you is a resolution authorizing BB&T Capital Markets basically to serve as our agent to do debt refinancing. What we're looking at doing at this point is our 2003 school bonds, our 2006 school bonds, A and B series. And total on that is about $45.6 million. And again, we looked at this a couple of times, but right now the markets are kind of viable to look at refinancing. And what we're projecting over the next 15 years that we should save about $2.2 million. First year savings should be about $490,000 and an annual savings of about $170,000. So by passing this resolution, this would set authorize him to be our agent and start the process to begin selling the bonds and getting qualified with the bond rating agencies.
This is the second time we've refinanced, I believe, recently. What was the savings on the first?
We saved about $130,000 a year. I forgot which series it was, but when we looked at it, these were not going to make any savings for us, so that's why we went back and seen if the market was better. That $130,000 savings is what our portion is to the new career tech. So that and lottery funds.
Yeah, okay, I remember this. We did something, yeah, okay.
Yes, sir.
Craig, when we retire the current bonds, is there a prepayment penalty associated with that, or does BB&T Capital Markets handle all that? Is that built into their cost?
It's built into their cost, yes, sir.
So what you have here about their price of $425 per bond and the management fee, that covers everything?
There's the underwriter and also the bond attorney is not covered. But as far as being the agent, it covers. We figured it out. It's about $51,000.
But your calculation of savings does include all those costs?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. It includes all the soft costs associated with refinancing.
Good. Any questions or Craig before we ask for a motion?
Our total indebtedness, somebody made reference to it this morning, as if it was real. Our bond indebtedness, for all intents and purposes, comparative terms and relative terms of the counties our size is actually pretty low, isn't it?
Our total debt is what, $12 million?
Total yeah. Outstanding?
No, I'm talking about debt service.
I was talking about gross debt.
Yeah. Oh, gross debt, I'm sorry.
Yeah. Our total outstanding debt is probably about 90.
Right.
And but yes, it is very low as far as the debt ratio, because it's based on the assessed valuation, right. And it I think it's under 1%.
Mm-hmm.
It's very low.
The state allows you to have a certain percentage.
It's mm-hmm. around 15.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and we're, what, you say 1?
I think it's under 1%.
Yeah. Well, you don't build a new school for $100,000,
right? That's right.
Well, and I believe when we talk about the debt service, that's not just the interest, that's whatever we're paying back.
Sure.
Interest, including.
Right. I think we budgeted 11. Million. It's
11 million in the current year.
Yeah, for this current year.
Okay, well, we'll entertain a motion that we support the resolution to refinance the debt as outlined by our county manager. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Tim. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Very good. Thank you, Craig, Tim, Amy, Susan, everybody that's involved in that. We'll now turn to the county manager reports.
I just wanted to mention we are diligently working on the proposed 2012-13 budget, and please don't forget our budget retreat of April 2nd at 9:30 at May Memorial. And that's all I have.
Thank you, Craig.
Question about the budget. We've only got another quarter left, right?
Yes, sir.
All right, how are we going to finish up? I mean, our revenues are down on what we talked about tonight, and
today we are revenues above expenditures about $4 million. We're probably going to we were trying not to use any fund balance this year, but it's probably going to be around $2 million.
What did you originally budget?
About $2 million.
A fund balance the first of the year?
Yes, sir.
Fiscal year. That was assuming, though, that the revenues were.
We were hoping not to use any fund balance this year, but it'll be about $2 million.
Okay. What did we budget for the first in the fiscal year?
This year?
Yeah.
$2 million.
So you put in?
Yes, sir.
We're going to use it.
We were trying not to use. We're doing everything we in our power not to use that.
So if we'd had revenues from the bed space that we had budgeted, you'd been $2 million too.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Well, I think Tim's question is a good one, and I guess what I would wonder is maybe for one of the April, well, the early April meeting, because we're meeting the same night as the budget retreat. I believe.
Yes, sir.
And maybe you're going to talk about this at the retreat, but can you give us through what would be, I guess, February you'll have, either that morning or that evening to exactly look at what Tim's asking?
Yes.
That would be very helpful.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah. It, We've made, without the great strides that we made as far as the cuts back in October, it would be much worse. So.
And I know I've asked you this before, and talked to you about giving a raise to the county employees. And I'm wondering, is there a possibility that we can give the employees a raise at all? I hate to put you on the spot, but you know, you and I already talked about this.
Come on, next year?
Or this for the next year.
For the upcoming year.
Yeah, for the upcoming year.
It's going to be very difficult. Where using under our current revenue structure, it's going to be very difficult. We're not going to have the flexibility to use fund balance like we have had in the past. So it's going to be very difficult. You know, have you seen a lot of the requests so far? You know, the schools have asked for 1.7 million more. ACT has asked for more. Everybody's asked for more. So it's going to be very difficult under our current revenue structure.
Well, I think y'all look at it closer to.
Well, I mean, going back just like Tim's question, it probably would be good to create the scenario of under what conditions a raise could be granted, and let's look at it.
I mean, that's what we're working on that now, and trying. We'll have bunches of different options for the board to consider.
Yeah, and that should be certainly one of them.
Oh yes, sir.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you, Linda. Mm-hmm. Eddie, Bill, anything? Yeah. Well, any announcements, Craig? Other than the budget retreat and our April meeting the same night, we also are meeting with the Farm Bureau Tuesday, April, is that the 3rd, Tori? And then we're waiting for Representative Engel to confirm and join us for a meeting with the commissioners, Representative Borston, Senator Gunn, later on in April.
Right.
I believe that's right.
19th. I haven't had a chance to call Representative Engel today.
Well, actually, Tori has that contact information.
Thank you.
Any other announcements at this time? Anything else to come before the board? If not, we stand adjourned. Thank you.
Good job.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.